Say welcome. Thank you for coming. Just a quick question. How many were at Foss North last year? And how many are new? It's 50-50.
That's great.
So we can grow even further next year. We're some practicalities. We're here. This is the big room, which is the left column in the program. And then the right column is upstairs. There's a big roll up outside the door, so you should be able to find it. And all the sessions are back to back in the program, but it's actually 15 minutes to do Q&A and group about in between the sessions. So it should be okay. Then we get lunch, which I believe is upstairs, but the venue staff will show us where that is. And for that, it's good to have a name badge, because then they know we're part of this group of people. There are name badges outside if somebody's missed them. I'd like to thank you for coming. It's you who make this possible. We couldn't do it without the speakers. I see some here and there, but the speakers wouldn't come without an audience. And we couldn't do it without the sponsors. So I'd like to thank you all for sort of tying this together and making it possible. And I just like to highlight this year's sponsors. Thank you very much for making it possible, for being the only And then I actually thought I'd just relax and hand it over to Lydia, our first keynote speaker.
Thank you very much. Thank you everyone for coming so early. I appreciate it. I want to talk a bit about Wikidata. For those who don't know me, I'm Lydia. I'm the product manager for Wikidata, and I'm also the president of KDEV, the nonprofit behind the KDEV community. But today I want to talk about Wikidata and the lessons we've learned along the way. Everyone needs access to knowledge. Be it the student who needs to write a term paper, or the mom who needs research, facts about an illness of the kid, and so on and so on. And a lot of people get that knowledge from Wikipedia. Who of you is reading Wikipedia? All right, that's a test. How many of you have edited Wikipedia? That's actually pretty good. Not bad. So, about 500 million people read Wikipedia every month. That's an enormous number. But a while ago, we looked at Wikipedia. This is English Wikipedia. And what you're seeing here is articles on English Wikipedia that are about a location. So this place gets a dot on this map, the Eiffel Tower gets a dot on this map, and so on and so on. Now, if you look at English Wikipedia, you can see the whole world. There's still a difference between North and South, but you can see the whole world. Now, let's look at some others. This is Spanish Wikipedia, Russian Wikipedia, Farsi, and Japanese. For some reason, Japanese people are really interested in Italy. But jokes aside, this is a huge problem, because it means that people who do not speak English or any of the other major languages do not get access to all the knowledge that we want to give them access to, and that they should have access to. Now, don't get me wrong, Wikipedia in this regard is considerably better than most of the web, but it's still far from where we want to be. So, 5 years ago, we started Wikidata in order to solve this problem. And Wikidata is a knowledge base that holds data about the world in a machine-readable way that can be edited by people and machines independent of the language, and so on. And that can then be shared between all the Wikipedias, but also whoever else needs general purpose data about the world. But there's also a community of people who maintain the data, who put the data in, who use the data. So more concretely, what does it look like? This is the entry for Mona Lisa in Wikidata. And it basically tells you that's a painting, that Leonardo da Vinci created it, that it's in the Louvre, stuff like that. And you can look at this in any language you like. So basically what we're trying to build in order to serve Wikipedia and others is a multilingual and multicultural project that acknowledges knowledge diversity. Why? I will get to. The current state of Wikidata, we have about 25 million items, that is, concepts in the world we know something about, like this building and so on. And we have about 3,300 properties to describe them. And with that, we're making 145 million statements. So stuff like Berlin is the capital of Germany. And all that is done by about 17,000 editors every month. Over the past 5 years that Wikidata exists, we've learned quite a few lessons. And I want to talk a bit about some of those. The first one, and I think the most important one, is that the world is really, really complex. And Wikipedians are really, really good at telling you how complex it is, where it is complex, and why it's important. And if you build a project that is supposed to cross language barriers and cultural barriers, then you need to deal with knowledge diversity. And with knowledge diversity, I don't mean fake news and so on. So let me show you some examples. When was Jesus Christ born? You don't want people fighting about one true fact there. Or what is Jesus Christ actually? Or there's also stuff like this woman who married the Eiffel Tower. Or thank you, Sweden. There's one year that has a February 13th. Why? 1700 something. Thank you very much. So these are just some of the things that we have to be able to deal with. But it's possible, and you can build tools that deal with a complex world. And I'm seeing more and more things like this. You go to a famous map provider on the internet, and you look at borders of countries. And depending on which country you are in, it will show you different borders to fit your worldview. And will not tell you anything about the fact that it's doing that. And I think that's really, really scary. Because if you don't show people that there are other people with different points of view and different opinions, that doesn't make them go away. They're still there, they're still holding their view, and you're taking away their ability to talk about those differences. And we're seeing this more and more, and that's, as a society, not helping us. So my lesson from Wikidata, it is possible to build tools to deal with knowledge diversity, to deal with a complex world in a way that people can understand. And we should do more of that. When you build a project with 17,000 volunteers, you have to be pretty sad about it. What do I mean by that? You can't do it all alone. There's just no way. And so you need to empower people to actually do some of the work with you. In order to do that, you need to trust them, that they can actually do work that is meaningful for the project and that is moving it forward and going in the same direction as everyone else. In order to do that, you need to do a lot of explaining why you're doing things the way you're doing them. And in order to do that, you need to listen a lot. And by listening, I mean actually listening, not just saying like, yeah, and then doing no. So at the same time, even if you do all that, some things will not go your well. So, and you need to learn to be zen about it and deal with that. Which brings me to the third thing. Wikidata isn't finished in any way yet, and it's also not yet the most easy to use tool. But even in the state we have, people are building amazing things using our software and our data. And I think this is important for many reasons. We as a society seem to be moving away from this ability to tinker, understanding that we can change the world around us. And that is so important for a little kid to understand that they can do things, be it with code or anything else around them. But only if you let people tinker can they start changing the world around them in order to help themselves and build tools for themselves. So here are some of the things that people have already done with Wikidata. This is the article about the South Pole Telescope on English Wikipedia, and the info box you're seeing here is coming completely from Wikidata. Before that, it was duplicated across all the languages that had such an article, and it was a huge blob of Wikitext, basically the equivalent of code on Wikipedia. Or here, that's a tool called Histropedia, which uses Wikidata to let you build timelines for education, for example. or here, it's a tool called Monumental that shows you information about monuments of historic significance around you. Or here is a tool called Wikidata Game, which asks you little questions like, is this Wikipedia article about a person or not? And depending on your answer, it will edit Wikidata for you. Nice thing to do while on the couch and watching Netflix. Or here, this is Inventaire, a website that uses Wikidata in order to show you profiles of authors and books. And then you can say, I own this book and I'm willing to give it away to friends or strangers. Or here, a very popular game with kids in Germany, Stadtland Fluss. Basically, you get a letter and then you have to find a city, a country, a river that starts with that letter. And this is basically this game built on top of Wikidata. Or here, Ask Platypus. It will let you ask a natural language question and then query Wikidata for the answer. So for example, if I ask it who the director of the movie Her is, it will tell me that's Spike Jonze. Which brings me to my last point. Data is one of the most important resources of our time. But in order to be truly empowering, it needs to be free, open, and editable. And I hope you're gonna join me and 17,000 other people on Wikidata to make that happen.
know, I'm a Norwegian, it's a small country, and so many people we don't usually have in Norway. And unfortunately, I have to tell this joke too, because by an inquiry in 1905, we unfortunately get separated. You should never tell that to a Norwegian. So, to my small introduction to IoT, it will be a little bit different, but before I start about this short poem, is that about this very simple stuff, about function mapping, which seems to be simple, but I will explain why it's complicated. My background, I've been working with free and open source software since mostly 2001, but I was starting my first Linux installation. It was a Slackware in 1996, and I used 3 weeks to get online. You know? This does not happen anymore. I'm very disappointed. You know, plug in Ubuntu and the installer we made in Debian in 2001 to 2003 just works out of the box. Everything works. It's fantastic. Don't quote me. This is a Trump quote. Okay? So I also worked with Joltec, which some of you probably know, with Qt. It was acquired by Nokia. Unfortunately, they went for Windows. 60,000 people had to go, nobody wants Windows Phone. So this is this, you know, reality. I remember I was standing on a floor and talked to people in education in Norway, and I told them, oh, you should switch to open source software or free and open source or GNU Linux, whatever. And they just looked at you and thought you were insane. Now we are just saying, are you using Windows? Are you insane? So the situation for free and open source software is totally different today than it was 15, 16 years ago. And I've been through that travel, which is very strange. We are the ones. We are the ones who are running the world. And here is the next level of the running the world thing. And that's what we have seen in healthcare. I use that as an example because most people, they talk about the Internet of Things, things that digs, things that walks, things that are robots. But here we should talk about what you will go into when you wear gray hair and partly disabled. No, you are born. It's like your parents, maybe, or your grandparents, and maybe me, 20, 25 years from now. So we have seen an unlikely happening where IoT is a part of elderly care, meaning that you can get treatment, you can get, you know, help, you can get different services by those IoT systems. For instance, when you are, if you have some problems, you might fall down, you might have walked away, then they don't call, you don't need to call on the phone. It just works with a voice. So you can talk to people nearby, which are in that person's approximately around that person. You can, if they have problems that they can't talk, you can maybe ask for help from some other person. And you have use cases which that's a part of people's life. It's give them, let's say, 50% participability, that's a new word, meaning that because you have this technology, you are a part of the society. Or else you're 100% disabled. We also have what we call geofence, which is a mechanism where people who are in dementia, they just wander away. And you can then just, you know, force them to be at home or at an elderly care institution. But it's much better to walk around because they keep the training of hair and you haven't done this. The dementia hitting that part, it kind of becomes delayed. That's a big, great thing. And of course you use a map and you draw out this drawing about where that person should walk and it becomes a huge area, no problem. But if they walk outside that fence, usually they tend to not find a home again. Or they just wander around and they will just wander, you know, can't find home, I will just wander, I'm here. And they hunger to death.
So we need to call in Red Cross, the police, the fire department, and the healthcare system to find those people, and we might not find them because it's just not an issue. GPS, geofence, no problem. We will just use one person to find them. Maybe in 20 minutes. Also, fall sensor is a great sensor, but we also have this in connection with a tablet or some voice system, and then by calming down the situation, assess the problem very fast, and if you set up the right thing. Heart conditioning, you probably have heard about the IoT heart condition, you measure everything these days. You might measure blood types, blood things in the blood, if you have a sugar, what you call it, help me here, thank you, diabetes problem. Then you can give a warning to some other person that they can help and assist, which is highly important. And those things you can just have as a wearable and connect it to the phone or something else, and it works. Also, pill dispensers, you regulate now with the Internet of Things, meaning that you can take the pill at the right time, which has been difficult, or you need additional manpower to have. Have some of you seen some of the elders' numbers of pills every day? Right, you have? Exactly. You know those these things, okay? And you need to help. You need a person not wrongly give maybe poisonous medicine if you take it wrong, okay? All these things are already installed in several municipalities in Norway. Not a lot, some. So what we see here is a range of use cases and features, from emergency calls, tracking heart conditions, automatic pill dispenser, lighting. We also have in elderly care something called in dementia. It's kind of sensory haven. They play music when you come into the room. They regulate the temperature, the light, and then they. Those who are having dementia, they remember things again. So it's the environment the elders are in are kind of tuned into their person when they enter the room, which is very, very interesting. I don't know about those things, but this is really fast, improving people's lives. And here it comes, and here's where we have to do something, and we are working on this. And this comes to what it ends up with today is that you have a pistol belt, all these regulatory things. It's no single app running the whole thing. It's maybe 20 different apps. So if you're a healthcare person, you look like a nerd at a free open source conference in New York from America. So when you have all these nice features, you have a virtual call with the phone, family maybe, you track here, you have tracking, fall heart conditions, you need to somehow make all these things work together. So what we have done in together with Standard Norway, together with e-health authorities in Norway, and Standard Sweden, and also British standards, Spanish, German, Finnish, and also we have other European countries coming into this equation, is how we should get all the sensory controls and actuators and sensors to work together in a kind of common space that you can control this for the person. So if you have a person who has incontinence, it means that you can't regulate your kind of water, then you have to clean up maybe the bed in the night. Then you know who's going to get the message and do that helping hand that person. It could be a family member, it can be a caretaker and some other person. And you get the message on your phone. So how should you communicate in this? That's the big question. And of course, we will use we are stopped using PCs as well. I will just take a short roundup on how we do this, and not only thinking about doing it, we already do it, and you will get shocked, because if you have done computers, Internet of Things, it's just a hardware integration mess you couldn't think of. You know, we talked about Wi-Fi problems, and I thought about Wi-Fi problems in 2002. It was a disaster. Bluetooth integration, my God. You know, getting a driver with your printer, you had to have an aunt in Sweden to go there and back again. So irritated he was. You know? So the thing is that it's an integration now, and not only by hardware, but also in this usage of the technology and controlling it. So what we have made and adapted here is what we call service standards and service templates, inspired by the Swedish healthcare authority. So you have service standards, which is what you do to help a person in a certain situation. If they're falling down or in pills or those kind of services, and we label them as services, abstract services. And then we make something called service templates, which is programmed, and it's very simple Internet of Things logic. It's simple actions, basically imperatives, as you know. Timers, things like that, and you just regulate that service for that person. For instance, geofence, you get mapping information, and you just check if they're outside the map. If they're outside the map, you should get an alarm, and this should happen totally automatically and be sent to the right person, caretaker, get that message. So we have put all these things together, and then we have also integrated a lot of different standard devices. And how this actually works is bus technology as the PCI bus in the computer. But it's different names. I will show you the list. But shortly, because this is a short talk, those things, the things which kind of do all these things and service that patient or that lady, are connected together with the service template, which give the service data connected with the service standard of Sweden. That's nice. So we had to go to Sweden to fix this. The reason we do this is to avoid the spaghetti. And you've probably seen in the beginning of the phones, very manufactured phones, and also the first traffic lighting was a mess. So we used many years to clean up that in the telecom and other, look at Microsoft, how bad they have treated standards. And it takes 10, 15, 20 years to fix it. So we have done a lot of work fixing it to handle all those standards. My God. This is the standard list and more which are integrated. And we do that simply by not removing devices to the people's life, which they absolutely need. My talk later today will also address more of this, so you can get more insight. But it's also a monetary effect on this. It's 200,000 Norwegian kroner saved on each bed getting this right in dementia care in Drammen. And they have return on investment in 123 days. I often ask them, why is it 1, 2, 3 days? Is it a password or something? No, it's actually 123 days. And also, this is very important, they did service innovation. They need to change the job because of the technology helping the person or the elderly. And, of course, some of those things can be done without technology at all. We don't need it. But the improvement is much better with technology. Thank you.
so glad to be here. Actually, looking at you, it reminds me going back to studying at Chalmers and sitting in sort of the computer lab, and I saw all these brilliant people around me, and I was like, to open up the computer, it was a Linux computer, and you had to run some software to make it run Windows and all that, and then my friend said, Carl, you know, the computer isn't dangerous. So if you multiply all the knowledge in computers you have here, and divide one by that, you will have the sum of my computer knowledge, basically. So bear with me. So this is me, Carl Josephson from Chalmers Ventures. I really do love mountains. I have a nickname in the office, Carl on a fucking mountain somewhere, Josephson. That's because I love skiing, being outdoors, and take my mountain bike down some slopes as well in the summertime. But my massive passion in life is actual people and products. I really love seeing things happen, seeing people grow, sort of having, you know, that ka-ching when someone really understands something new. I spend my days at Chalmers Ventures running the startup camp this spring, which is a 10-week program where you get some basic insights on how to run a startup. I'm also responsible for our whole community and all the different projects and processes we run to implement them right now. And I like to see myself as a free-spirited rebel all year round. Please do tweet. You have my Twitter handle there and also Chalmers Ventures. So I'm here to talk a little bit about startups. And one big misconception of a startup is that it's a smaller version of a large company. Sort of like you take Volvo Cars, for example, which is a big company, I guess most of you know, or IBM or Microsoft or something like that. And then you sort of make a smaller version of that, and then you have a startup. And nothing could be more wrong, because there's no similarities between a large organization and a startup. In a large organization, you have hierarchies, you have different fancy job titles. I usually say to everyone in a startup, oh, you have they write CEO of the startup, and they are the only one employed. And it's like, you know, it's, if someone looks in the books or go into the bookkeeping or check your company out, they're going to understand that you're basically not a CEO. The only job description you have in a startup is trying to get everything done, basically doing whatever it takes to make things succeed and move farther. A large company also, usually, unless you are Nokia some years ago, have quite an amount of resources behind them. They have a lot of cash and they have a lot of people, and of course, a startup does not have that at all. They are low on basically anything except passion. So if you have a large company, they spend their time drawing up fancy plans. They have like a strategic department, and they say in 10 years or 2 years or 5 years from now, we're going to be here and we're going to do this. And they make a plan for that, and then they go out and execute. So you know, you going into Gothenburg, you see Volvo Cars releasing all these new models on a new platform. That platform started 10 years ago when they decided to design a platform for a new series of cars, and they hired a lot of engineers and they put a lot of people, and then eventually they hired a fancy, super expensive ad agency, had slot on drive some cars in commercials, etc., etc. Then they launched in a big marketing campaign, and now you could see the cars being out here running on the streets. That doesn't work for a startup. How many of you know boom.com back in the millennia? Yeah, it was sort of the super cool startup of those days, trying to sell fashion online, and they sort of spent like trillions of money flying Concorde across the pond to US, etc., etc. And then they launched this, and everything like boom crashed. Various reasons. If you look at a startup today, they focus on searching and learnings. So they try to find things and they try to learn things. And this is, the picture behind is actually from Stalin or Lenin, and like the Soviet Union 5 years plan, and everybody knows what happened to the Soviet Union, I guess. The 5 year plan did not work out that well. So the same goes for a startup. And you can spend all the time and money writing a business plan, and then when you're finally there, you spend like tons of times writing and finishing and polishing your business plan, and then you walk out and say, "Hey customers, here I am, do you want to buy my product?" And they say, "No." So in the words of Mike Tyson, it's actually that everybody has a plan until they get punched in the face. And the same goes for startups. So don't spend your time writing fancy plans if you're a startup. I hope my Porsche is down there in the corner, see if I was going to talk later. They are example that they have been out there, not writing business plan, but out talking to customers. And this is super important to bear in mind, that plans do not work. Not ever for a startup. So what is it that makes a startup unique? You can have a startup that is quite large in terms of people being employed, but it's sort of the methodology they use. And they are searching for a specific need, a specific problem, for a specific customer or a specific user. That is their main goal. That comes before executing a business plan. And anybody who's seen Indiana Jones and the Quest for the Holy Grail knows that he might have had some plans, but they didn't work out, but eventually, finally, he found the Holy Grail. The same goes for a startup. So a startup, they operate when the problem is unknown and the solution is unknown. So all these things, your customer problems, your product solution features, all about that is hypothesis that needs to be tested. And one big misconception in a startup is that you have to be some sort of divine business guru to understand this. But the mythology right now in the Lean Startup ecosystem is basically, it's like a researcher. You test things repeatedly and see what works and what does not work. So what you do is you formulate your hypothesis on your customer user problems. You test these size processes on the customer, real time, directly. And then you listen and learn from what the customer is saying to you or how they experience it. And I guess some of you do this already working agile in different projects. You can do A-B testing, you can do smoke tests, you can do visited NOS tests, etc., etc., which is very normal for a startup. So this is sort of the loop for a startup. You have some idea of what you want to do, and then you build it. And then you go out and test it on the customer side. Then you learn, monitor, take that knowledge back, refine, and this is a loop moving back and forth. So how come that the biggest taxi company today don't even own taxi cars? How come that the world's biggest wholesale chain nowadays does not own a single bed? It would have been super easy for a traditional taxi company to actually do what Uber and Lyft have done. They had the car, they had customer loyalty, they had anything, everything about it, but they didn't because they're slow. And Uber, Airbnb, you have Alibaba, you have all these different companies that are skyrocketing because they are fast. And it goes back to David and Goliath. It's not the big ones that outcompete the small ones. It's the fast ones that outcompete slow ones. Nokia started off with rubber boots, moved into tires, moved into television sets, moved into mobile phones, dominated the world. And where are they now? They're trying to relaunch the old like soap telephone with Snake Game on it. We'll see how that goes. So going to our startups at Shamans Ventures, we have some few of them. We have around 100 companies that we have started together with one of the entrepreneurs that we are part owners in. Today we have SignaStocks, for example. It's stock management for dummies. Basically, they help you to set up a stock portfolio, so you don't need to go to the bank and get into a fund. You could actually use their software to build your own stock portfolio out of your decision needs. So you save money, you don't have to pay the bank for commissions on the funds. They have already more than 1,500 customers. They are growing 22% per month. Yesterday, this company did not exist. Tomorrow, a bank may not exist. You have Raise One, which comes out of Marlene, who was standing in the starting line when her boyfriend was going on ski races, and then she had to go from Sälen to Mora in the Vasaran and cheered him when he got there, and had no communication, couldn't understand what he was doing and where he was during the race. So they have built a mobile app where spectators, family and friends can follow you when you do the Gothenburg Run, when you do the Norrnorsk Marathon, etc., etc. They have now more than 250 races, and they reach more than 120,000 athletes. And yesterday, this company did not exist. You have Bonsai. They rent out, or you could hire students for extra work you needed in your company without needing to employ someone. They have more than 400 customers. They have more than 2,000 consultants, students working for them, and they have already reached more than 4,000 hours being delivered through their platform. This company did not exist yesterday. Tomorrow, some of the staffing companies may not exist. So what does all these companies, Bonsai, Raise One, and SignaStocks, have in common, you guess? They do experiments on real customers. They do lots of experiments on real customers. Testing the RIDs over and over again. They make sure that the customer is only offered exactly what they want. They do all these tests over and over again. Yeah. Also, what they have in common is that they really want to disrupt the dinosaurs. They really want to put a dent in the world. They really want to change something. When you ask them, it's not about making money. When you ask SignaStocks what they want to do, is to give the power back to the people in terms of not giving money to the banks. If you ask Marlene why she started Race One, it's because she wants to follow her family and friends when they do races. She wants to share their joy. And she wants them to share her joy when she's done a race. And when you talk to the guys founding Race One, they want to give money and help students get better economy. And basically, when you talk to all of them, they're software companies, of course, this wouldn't be possible without free and open source software. They use it every time. Because if they had to build everything from scratch, they wouldn't be fast, they wouldn't be agile. So, basically, the sum of all this is why startups love free and open software. Thank you so much.